today, the Dhamma talk, the topic is about free your mind. Also, if you have seen my card on the back side, I printed free your mind. So it's one of my slogans I use, and it's one of my main concerns. How to free your mind, how to develop your mind, also how to overcome all the fetters which chain you to this existence. So when it comes to real spirituality, it should be based on experience, it should be based on the truth. The time has come to abandon theories, beliefs, and to become practical. And if we look worldwide, we can also see that that is exactly what humanity is asking for. So humanity no longer likes to just blindly believe any dogma. They want to find out for themselves, they want to see, they want to experience it. And if it's not helpful, if it's not improving their day-to-day life, they are no longer interested in it. And the most important part of this spiritual practice is meditation. There's a Zen saying, it says you should meditate for 20 minutes every day. Unless you're too busy, then you should meditate 1 hour, because then you need it much more. It's a very old Zen saying, and it is true. It was true at that time, and it's even more true nowadays. Prince Siddhartha, after he saw the 4 famous signs, meaning an old person, a sick person, and a dead body, he realized there is a lot of suffering around us. He also is subject to the same suffering. So he left behind his luxury life, he left behind the palace, in search of the solution to this problem. So the main reason why he left the palace was to find the solution to suffering. He wanted to find the end of suffering for himself and also for humanity. The Buddha, as you know, is not a name, it is a title. It was given to the Prince Siddhartha after he attained enlightenment. So it means the enlightened one or the awakened one. Also, according to him, he is not the only Buddha. There have been thousands of Buddhas before him, and there will be many more after him. He even gave once a long list of names of the past Buddhas, like Vasubhu, Sikhi, and many other. So even the names are known from all these past Buddhas. And also, last time I was asked, when is the next Buddha coming? And according to the Buddha, there will be a long gap between this Buddha and the next Buddha. So usually they don't come too often. They come only at the time where people are no longer have the Dhamma or no longer can remember the Dhamma. And also a time where people can understand the Buddhist teachings or the Dhamma teachings. So the Dhamma is universal knowledge, universal understanding. It is the path to enlightenment. Also, the Buddhist teaching called Dharma often is also, the word Dharma is used also in other religions, in other traditions. So I believe that all religions contain a little bit of Dharma, but mainly the term is used in Buddhism and also in Hinduism. So it means the philosophy of life, the way, the technique, how to develop your mind, how to free your mind from all defilements. If it can be destroyed by the truth, it deserves to be destroyed by the truth, Carl Sagan. So meaning if it's not based on the Dharma and it can be destroyed by true things, then it is not worth saving anyway. So if it's something is based on the Dharma, based on the truth, it cannot be destroyed. Also many may try, especially at bad times, the Dharma is constantly under attack. But they say humanity can be destroyed, but not the Dharma. So the Dharma will be always there, only there is a golden time and there's a bad time, so the amount of Dharma available will be different. The Buddha nature is what I call also the universal consciousness, or the enlightened nature is already in you. So each and every one of you has this Buddha nature within you. Usually it is covered up with karma, with defilements and things, so it cannot shine. Through meditation we purify the subconscious mind, we clean out all the rubbish, and we let this Buddha nature shine forward. Also the Buddha said enlightenment is nothing, you have to go to another place, you have to, some call it a journey, which is only literally, not literally, sorry, it's implied meaning. So you don't go anywhere, the Buddha nature is within you. So you clean out your mind, then Buddha nature starts shining and enlightenment comes forward. There is the musk deer is very famous in northern countries, and this deer has a peculiarity. It is very fascinated by the smell of musk. That's why it's called the musk deer. If it gets a slight smell of the musk, it's running like crazy, searching everywhere. It loses its mind just to find the musk, and it's its favorite. And it's often compared to a human being who is crazy with desires. As soon as we get an idea, I could satisfy certain desires, we run like crazy, we search everywhere. We are prepared to give almost anything just to satisfy this one satisfaction, to get this satisfaction. So often also even when it comes to the spiritual search, many students run here and there confused, searching for some technique to liberate the mind. Also, there is a variety of teachings out there which can be very confusing. And also many say, which books should we read? What is the right technique? Which meditation do you recommend? So there are many different meditation systems out there which are practically good. But it all depends on your experience, on your practice. So whenever we think that a certain teaching or a certain meditation technique is good for us, we should put it to the test. So you try it, you experience it a little bit. If it is improving your life, and especially if your negative things like greed, hate, delusion is getting down, then you can take it as something real, as something true. So reaching for the you that exists beyond all the drama is what the spiritual search is all about. So it is all about your self-realization. It's not about learning things by heart and then teaching it or arguing with people. It is your own spiritual practice. So you clean out your heart, you develop the Buddha nature, and you move on to higher levels of consciousness. The old Romans had one word, liber, which is the base for two words. It's the base for library and also for liberty. And they say the old, all these terms have not been chosen randomly, they have been chosen very wisely. So knowledge, the library standing for knowledge, is a big part, or you need certain knowledges for liberation. So knowing things, understanding things, having a deep knowledge is very important when it comes to liberation. Also, once you sit down in meditation, it is also important not to forget about everything. But before that, knowledge, understanding can give you an idea where to go. So it gives you an idea what to do in your practice, where to go, what is the aim of your practice. And then once you start with the real meditation, then it depends all on your experience. Like I said, many times when you go to a big meditation center, like I was in Burma, the first thing they ask you, do you have any books with you? Put it aside, and now start the practice. But before that, even the idea to go to a meditation center to meditate, you need some knowledge, some understanding what you're up to. So it can give you an direction, but once you sit in meditation, the best is to forget about everything. Another big distraction is often glorification of a certain person. And we see this often, and I choose a Buddhist picture because it happens in Buddhism as well. So in many traditional Buddhist countries, monks are glorified, or the monks worship. They call it the monks worship. There's a saying, it says, the leaders destroy followers and the followers destroy leaders. So this idea, the Buddha never recommended this personality worship. And there was a monk at the Buddha's time who was terribly in love with the Buddha. He always wanted to see the Buddha, he was near him, he idolized the Buddha. Till it became a big hindrance for his spiritual practice. Then one day, I think Wakkali was his name, one day the Buddha sent him off. He realized this is a hindrance for this monk. He sent him off far away into the forest. He said, you go far away and do your meditation practice. At first it was very hard for him because he had to break this attachment to the Buddha. But then after a while he got into real meditation and he attained enlightenment. So nowadays also in many Asian Buddhist countries you hear on that hill is a holy monk, there is a holy monk, and there are 500 holy monks. And I don't believe any of these stories. Also if some monk says, I am enlightened, I am this or that, then you can be sure that he is not. So I think enlightenment means you are free from ego. And if somebody is advertising his own attainment, that means the ego is huge. And so it cannot be true. So I don't believe in any of these stories. Another big hindrance is opinions, theories, and concepts. And often we get a variety of ideas, which can be very confusing. And again, you have to base it on your own experience. So whatever we hear, often it is good to introduce new things into our practice. Let's say I read something about a different meditation and I take certain parts, introduce it into my meditation practice, but again I should try it for a while. And if I see it is working for me, then take it and introduce it into your practice. If you see after a while this is not working, it makes me more restless, or it brings me away from my attainments, then you drop it again. So opinions, theories, and concepts can become a huge hindrance. Also, I think the human mind is very fond of certain ideas, or we like to argue with people. There's also one part of the Buddhist teaching, which is called the Abhidhamma, which is not very practical, but it's full with lists and Pali terms. And somebody told me once, it's absolutely not important to have to know Abhidhamma for your practice, but it has one big advantage. If you sit down with another person and you want to argue, you become very good at arguing with other people, and you can impress the people with your Pali knowledge. But beyond that, it's not very practical, it's not very useful. So the trouble with being in a rat race is even if you win, you're still a rat. By Lily Tomlin. So meaning if you are in this modern society, and even if you are the best, still you are in the race. And the main idea would be to get out of the race, to see it with some distance and to understand the whole race is not really what we should be up to. We should be more for realization, understanding, and freeing our mind from all defilements. Also, our modern society, we can see many shortcomings, many problems, many say it's going in the wrong direction. And according to, there's another saying from Krishnamurti, it is not a measure of health to be well adjusted to a profoundly sick society. And these are usually the people who, let's say, the multi-billionaires or the people on top, who are perfectly adjusted to this system and they profit from it a lot, so they're doing very well, but it's usually not a sign of health, because in this system, if you want to go, if you want to reach the top, then usually you cannot keep any human values, or you cannot be a spiritually advanced person, otherwise you would never arrive on the top. Bodily and mental sickness. Now everybody understands if you want to be bodily very fit, then you have to do something for your body. So you go to a fitness center, you work very hard. Or you can see this, the people in sports, they train very hard and they work very hard to be bodily very fit. When it comes to mental fitness, many people don't realize even that needs a lot of training. So when it comes to meditation or spiritual progress, many people think that they go to a retreat or they sit down once or twice in meditation and then they expect some big results. So even there, it is a training, it takes a while till you develop your mind. Like the bodily training, you have to work hard for it. Also, we had this discussion recently that there are many stories in our Buddhist texts. The people came to the Buddha, they listened to one short advice of the Buddha and they became fully enlightened. There are nowadays teachers around who promise the same thing. they say, don't meditate, not necessary, just come listen to my Dhamma talk and then you will be enlightened. And if you say, how is this possible? They say, look at these stories. At the Buddha's time, the Buddha did the same thing. And my answer to this is usually, people who are born at Buddha's time, and especially people who met the Buddha and became enlightened in within a short, like say, they hear one sentence of the Buddha and they become enlightened, these are usually people who have huge paramis. That means they have a lot of experience from the past. And nowadays, people who come from meditation, they have good paramis already. But compared to these people who attained enlightenment in the presence of the Buddha, our paramis are fairly low. And so nowadays we need to work very hard for it, so we have to put in a lot of time and energy. Then I think it is still possible to make some progress to attain any of these stages. But nowadays it's not that easy. Also we can see society-wise it is getting more and more confusing, so our society is very complex. The life at the Buddha's time, as we believe it was very simple. So village life, people lived a very simple life. They did not have any of the electronic devices. And I saw recently a nice cartoon with somebody in love with his phone. And first, it was a poem. First it starts like, he's in love with the partner. It sounds like he's in love with a girl, but then it turns out he means the phone. And so life is very complex nowadays, and it makes it more and more difficult to make progress. So there's no liberation without meditation. So without actually sitting down and doing the practice, I think there are no liberation is possible nowadays. So anybody who says you don't need any meditation in order to make some spiritual progress, theoretically possible, but nowadays unlikely. Now this is the list of fetters the Buddha gives. They're called the sanyojanas, the 10 fetters, which bind us to this material existence. So all these things are things which hold us back from our spiritual progress. And in order to make some progress, we have to break them. What are they? Personality, belief, skeptical doubt, clinging to rules and rituals, sensual desire, ill will, and the last five are very fine mental attachments. So these fetters, they are translated, the sanyojanas translated as the mental fetters, which shackle a sentient being to samsara. These chains can be broken through meditation or through any spiritual practice. The word sanyojana comes from san, defilements, and yo, bind. So it binds us to our defilements, it binds us to this material existence. Don't look down on the defilements, they will laugh back at you. And the meaning is never underestimate your defilements. They can put up quite a fight and it can be very difficult sometimes to overcome them. Also, each person has a particular defilement. Often it is from person to person, it can be very different. Let's say somebody can't stop gambling. If you're not a gambler, nobody will understand how it is not possible for him to stop it. Like I know one person in my country, he says he knows the disadvantage, he has lost a lot of money with it. He tries not to gamble. But he says each time he passes by a gambling hall, he just the car stops automatically. He goes in and he says only 10 euro, and he goes home with minus 1,000. And so for him it is a defilement; he cannot overcome it, or without any help, it's very impossible for him to overcome it. And from outside, it may look it's a small thing; it should be very easy, but not for that particular person. So the defilements are designed for each person in a different way. Each one has his weakness, and the defilements hit you very hard at your weakness. Also here we can see this, the sanyojanas, they are directly connected with the four stages of awakening. So if you break or overcome the first three sanyojanas, you are sotapanna, or you reach the first stage of enlightenment. The second, the fourth and the fifth, which is sensual desire and ill will, if you reduce them, you attain the second stage, and if you overcome them completely, you are on the third level or an anagami. The first, the last five are broken, then you are an arahat or fully enlightened. Usually from outside, it is, many try to guess where is this person, how far is he. It is from outside, it's very difficult to say anything, if at all, the third stage. So if somebody has broken sensual desire and ill will completely, that is something more obvious from outside. So if you associate a person, he gets never angry, he does never show any grasping or strong attachment, and he is very clear, he's not confused. So if you see this for a long period of time, maybe we can guess that a certain person is on that level, but even that cannot be said for sure. There's another, as you know, the jhana meditation, which is on the samatha side. If somebody is doing jhana meditation for a long time, then also the defilements are completely suppressed for a long period of time. You may not see any defilements, but they're still there. They're just suppressed. Kicho manushya patilapo, rare is the human birth. So it's very difficult to be reborn at the right place at the right time. Also to be born as a human being, to hear the Dhamma, to get an opportunity to do meditation, to be intelligent enough to understand it, and also from outside, society-wise, to have a chance to practice the Dharma or the meditation is a very rare opportunity. So if we have all these rare chances, then we should make best use of it. It's never sure whenever, we don't know when you get such a chance again. So for you, you are born in, or you're living in a good country, you have the chance to meditate. It is very well known now, the Dharma or Buddhism, and there are places like BSV where you can practice meditation. So meditation can change your life, comprehending the anicca nature. Now, one of the first things, if you make some progress in this mindfulness meditation, is the understanding of anicca. Got a cold again. So anicca, the impermanence, when you start seeing the impermanence on an experiential level, it is one of the biggest insights or the biggest progress in your meditation. Once you clearly see the impermanence all around you, then automatically also the grasping or the attachment is going down. So you no longer grasp things in the same way, because you know, even if it's the most beautiful, let's say the newest iPhone, you know after a while it's wearing off or you lose it or it breaks, it is impermanent. So having this impermanent in your mind, your grasping will be automatically much less. As soon as the grasping goes down, also the anger or the ill will be much less. Now if somebody is really living a bad life, usually we are reborn, what the Buddha called an apaya. According to the Buddhism, there are six different ways of being reborn. Only one of these six, manusha means here human, the human world. Devaloka means you are born as a spirit, some would call it a god. In Buddhism is nothing so special. So if somebody lives a good life, does a lot of good things, creates a lot of good karma, you can be reborn as a deva, but even this, it's said they have a very long lifespan, but even that is not permanent. So after that karma is paid off, you come down again and you are reborn in a different place. Manushya Loka would mean the human world, it's said to be the best, also it is the second on the list, because as a human you can see the suffering, you can see the good and the bad, and you can do a lot of good karma and practice meditation. The last four are called abhaya, these are places of suffering, one of them is the animal realm, or the other all spirit as a spirit or bad spirit, a ghost. So these are usually places for paying off bad karma. What we call the Divaloka or the heavenly realms, as already mentioned, is just a result of your good karma. It is not permanent, so you live there a long lifespan, you enjoy your life. But it's also said it's not a perfect place for doing anything spiritual, or it's not a good place for making spiritual progress. The reason is, or the simile they give, suppose you go to a party, loud music and joy and fun and everything, everybody's happy, and try to sit down at a party and meditate. It's almost impossible. So Divalok is similar to that. It's like party day and night. Also, there's no real suffering there. Bodily, they don't get sick, they don't need medicine, or they don't need any food. So the enjoyment is great, but there's not a big chance there to develop your mind any further. So coming back to the Sanyojanas, the first one is called Sakkayaditi, personality view. And that is also one of the, along with Anicca, usually we understand the Anatta, meaning the non-self nature. Sakkayaditi means, would be the personality belief. So if you break that, you understand that there's no I, me, or mine. There are just processes going on in your mind, so connected with your six senses. The mind is rotating around these impressions. Past memories are conditioning your thinking. There is no ego or nothing we call I, me, or mine. So it comes along with the anicca, impermanence, insight into that. The anicca, dukkha, and anatta. Seeing it from another angle, often tanha mana ditti is also called the hindrances for making spiritual progress. Tanha means grasping, attachment. Mana is again this conceit, the I, me, or the ego. And ditti would mean beliefs, having strong ideas about certain things. And here ditti does not mean differences in opinion about smaller things. It has to do with these main important ideas. It would be like the Buddha or any wrong idea about all the enlightened beings, thinking there never has been any enlightened being, nobody has ever attained anything. Dharma, if you the belief is there is no true teaching, there is no technique to liberate the mind, it's impossible. Karma, if you have a wrong idea about karma, meaning whatever I do, it has no effect, nothing is coming back to me, I can do whatever I want. Desire, that the grasping or having desire is a hindrance for spiritual progress. And that one actually I hear often. There are many, in Europe I know many alternative living people who are otherwise very close to being a Buddhist, but this is one point which many cannot get. Holding on to things or desire, that is also a hindrance for making spiritual progress. Meditation, that there is something, a technique which can liberate the mind, or just the wrong idea about liberation itself, that it is just not possible. We live our life. At the end of the life, it's like switching off a machine and that's the end of it. So having any wrong idea called drushti or ditti about these major things which are really important for your spiritual progress would mean it's a big hindrance for moving forward in your meditation. Vichikicca, the second fetter, is doubt about this. I should have put the slide after that. About any of these major things. So if you doubt any of these ideas that the Buddha was enlightened, the Dhamma leads to enlightenment, meditation will liberate your mind, and that there is something called enlightenment. So if you do not believe in any of these, that would mean strong doubt, which will not allow you to move forward in your meditation. The third one is Silapada Paramasanang, attachment to rules and rituals, and that is also often we see it throughout all the different traditions and religions, but also within Buddhism. And that means, let's say I'm a Buddhist and I do my chanting, I do my rituals, my offerings and things, and I stop with that. So I do only the traditional things, believing that alone will be enough for me to liberate my mind. So if I use all these ritualistic things like chanting and puja for my meditation, then it can be even a help for the practice. But if I think that alone is enough and that alone makes me a practicing Buddhist, then that is Silapada Paramasanang. It's one of the fetters which we should overcome in our meditation. So what you need to attain the first stage of enlightenment, something is citta vitta. It has to do with your senses and what we are doing in this vipassana or mindfulness meditation. So you watch your mind, you observe the sensations. Whenever something comes into your field, you note it as a sound, a sensation, a thought, an image. You do not analyze it, you just stop it there and move on with your meditation. That is called cittavitti, the observation of your sense impressions. The traditional line for practicing Buddhism is this one, sila, samadhi, banya. Sila would mean the virtue. Now, if you keep these five precepts, which we renewed just in the beginning, it gives you the basis for meditation and any spiritual practice. So somebody who is not keeping at least these five precepts, however much you meditate, maybe you find some little bit of calm, but next time you break one of the precepts again, it drags you down again, so you cannot continue or you don't lift off in your meditation. Samadhi would mean the concentration meditation, and banya is the wisdom or the mindfulness meditation. So it's based on your virtue, then concentration, and then mindfulness meditation. The fourth of the Sanyojan is called Kamaraga, or sensual desire. So the Buddha, it is said, when he was sitting under the Bodhi tree, he was tempted in different ways away from his enlightenment. Either these stories could be literal or they could be just symbolic. So it is said some beautiful girls came there and tried to seduce the Buddha away from his seat of enlightenment. They were dancing in front of him. It could be all in his mind, or it could really have happened out there. He did not go into it. He continued his meditation, so it was not successful. He overcame his sensual desires. Then after that, ill will, so he was, it is said, the army of Mara came and tried to frighten the Buddha or make him angry. Again, he did not move. He continued his meditation. He overcame his ill will or his anger. And then he attained Buddhahood under the Bodhi tree. So these two, sensual desire and ill will, are usually the ones, the most prominent ones, the most difficult ones to overcome. Once you overcome them, it is called you are healthy again. So free from the karma loke, becoming healthy again. So once you overcome these, usually you are not reborn again in a sensual world, so you're not reborn again in a human world or anything below. If you come back and are reborn again, only in a higher spiritual realm. So the Sakadagami is somebody who has reduced sensual desire and ill will, and the Anagami is somebody who has completely overcome any sensual desire and ill will. For the Anagami, only these five very fine fetters are still left. One is craving for material existence, craving for non-material existence, conceit or egotism, restlessness, and ignorance. As we can see, the last bit of conceit disappears at the very end. Also, the last bit of ignorance, so some little bit wrong motion is still there. We overcome it at the end before we become fully enlightened. So these are the sanyojanas connected with the four stages of awakening. So even if we do not think about these things in our meditation, if you just practice the right meditation technique, you will overcome one by one automatically. But just the theoretical understanding, so that is what you are doing, that is what you have to overcome in your meditation. So enlightenment, joy, and peace can never be given to you by another. The well is inside you, Dishadan. So again, it's an inside job. Nobody else can do it for you. I always said if, let's say, the Buddha would sit here and he could not do the meditation for us, again, he could just show us, go that direction. That's what you have to do. Maybe he would explain a way of doing meditation, but we ourselves have to do it. So right understanding, seeing things as they really are. So we have to understand the anicca, dukkha, anatta, so the impermanence, the suffering nature, and the non-self nature. So without this correction of vision, it will be difficult to gain understanding and wisdom. So it leads to one of these four stages of awakening. Knowing others is wisdom, knowing yourself is enlightenment, Lao Tzu. And I read the most important book from Lao Tzu, the summary of his teachings, and actually he lived before the Buddha. And if you compare it with the Buddhist teaching, it's amazing, like it's almost the same. So he was very close to the Buddhist teaching and a book full of wisdom and understanding. So I think it's called the Tao Te. So if you read a book, it's an amazing read, and you will see, as a Buddhist, you will see that there are many similarities there. You will remember George Carlin, I use him sometimes. He said this, those who dance are considered insane by those who can't hear the music. And I changed that a little bit into those who meditate are considered insane by those who never tried it. And you hear this very often when people who have no idea about meditation and they see people sitting in meditation, maybe in a group meditation, they think it's crazy, what are they doing there? And sitting there like numb, not talking and not moving. So if you have no idea about what we are doing, it may look insane for others, but actually it's the technique to make you sane again. So the liberation of self is your own responsibility. So our situation here is all caused by our past karma. All the good and bad things we have done in the past have brought us to this stage. And I think for us, we have done a lot of good things, I guess, in the past. Otherwise, we would not have got this opportunity. So it is still a good chance to liberate the mind. Some say, you know, society is going in a certain way. Who knows how long we still have an opportunity to practice together like this. But at least for now, we have the opportunity and we can use it. So enlightenment, the Buddha had to overcome all his defilements, all his desires. The Buddha never claimed to be reborn as a holy being or a divine being. He was born as a prince, he was born as a human being, he was married, he had a child, so he had all the defilements usually human beings have. On his own, he left all this behind. He meditated, he worked very hard, 6 years he meditated under the Bodhi tree, and he overcome his own defilements. So I think the main idea of meeting the girls and meeting the army was overcoming his desire and his anger in his own mind. Once he was over all that, only then he reached the higher levels of awareness and he became a Buddha. If you want to put the Buddhist teaching into one word, many say this is the one, Tanhakkayo. Tanha means desire or grasping, and Tanhakkayo means the opposite, so not grasping or letting go of all desires. So if you want to put the Buddhist teaching in one word, this is the one. So we are working to let go of all grasping, of all desire, to liberate the mind from all defilements. It's also called Nirodha. To destroy the desire is the aim of the Buddhist teaching. Desire often is also compared to an itch. So if you have an itch, you try to scratch it. It's like satisfying the senses. And there's this saying, whenever we have an itch, we scratch, but better than any amount of scratching is to have no itch at all. And that is exactly what we do in this meditation technique, in the Buddhist practice. We try to remove the itch completely. And otherwise, however much we run after our desires, we may be, let's say, a very rich person, very influential person, can get a lot of his desires fulfilled. But as soon as they are fulfilled, a new desire is coming up. So this is no end to it. There's only one way to get real satisfaction, to get rid of the desire completely. So in Buddhism, we don't fight our defilements, we understand them. And when we know them, they disappear. So once you sit in meditation, Whenever defilements are coming up, you should neither hold on to it nor should you push them away. Let's say some negative memories are coming up in your mind and you're saying, oh, this is a terrible thought, and you try to push it away. The more you push it away, the more it's coming back. Or on the other side, let's say some nice memory is coming up, you try to hold on to this memory, you're very fond of this memory. Again, it will grow stronger in your subconscious mind. In meditation, whatever memory comes up, just acknowledge it. You say, ah, this is a memory, or this is a thought, and then you move on with your meditation. So if you note it with equanimity and you do it well enough, that memory cleans out from the subconscious mind, and it usually never comes back again. So nobody can be told what the matrix is, and matrix I use like reality, our reality around us. That's the saying, of course, is from the movie The Matrix, and the Buddha said something very similar. He said nobody can be told what enlightenment is. Each and everyone has to walk the path on his own, and we have to find out for ourselves. The Buddha says, I can only show the way, but everybody has to experience it for him or herself. So reality, this isn't real. What is real? How do we define reality? What is real? It's all just in our mind. It is mind-made. The Buddha's line is mano pubbangama dhamma. Mind-made are all things. Mind is the forerunner of all things. Now, Elon Musk definitely agrees with that one. He says there is one in a billion chance that we are living in base reality. So he believes our reality is not real. He says it's a computer game or a simulation. That's what he says. And he says there's a tiny chance that this is real, and there's 1 billion chances it is not. The Buddha called it Mahamaya, the great illusion, from which we should wake up. We can break out of this maze or this illusion, but we have to stop doing what we are used to do, to conform with the world and to just accept everything we are told to. So we have to use our own critical thinking to break out of this illusion, to look behind the curtain and to understand how things actually are. Blind belief is one of the big hindrances. So blind belief in authority is the greatest enemy of truth, Albert Einstein. And Jay Krishnamurti said something very similar. So whenever we have a strong belief in anything, in any authority, in a holy book, in even a holy teacher, whatever, it becomes a strong hindrance for our spiritual progress. Noble friendship is one of the most important things when you are on the path to enlightenment. Ananda, who was the closest monk to the Buddha, his attendant, and also his closest friend, he said once to the Buddha, I think the noble friendship is half of the spiritual life. It's very important. And the Buddha said, no, that's wrong. It is not half of the holy life. It is the whole holy life. So he said the spiritual friendship, noble friendship, is the most important thing if you are practicing meditation, practicing spirituality. Also sometimes if you are into meditation, into making spiritual progress, there can be many difficult periods to overcome. If you have some real good friends around you, you can share your experience, you can discuss things. And just by their presence, just by the vibrations, the positive vibrations around you, that alone can be enough to overcome difficult periods. So true friends say good things behind your back and bad things to your face. And that's one way to find out if somebody's a really good friend. So true friends, usually if you do anything wrong, they come up and tell us straight away. They say, I'm your best friend, but I think this is now wrong, you're going wrong here, and the good friend has the right to do that. But if they do this, you can be sure they are not telling bad things around you. They come up to you and they tell it straight away. So that is one sign of a good friend. And also in the background, if we talk positive about our friends, he said he did this great thing and that great thing. And we are not even interested that person finds out about it. We just are happy with spreading good information about our friends. Now these two are also very good friends. And many people ask me, because last time I talked a little bit about politics, and so many say, what do you think about, I heard you shouldn't even say his name, because when you should say the present president of the United States. If you call his name, it leads to outrage. And so some say, are you left, are you right, what do you think about him? I think they are here for our entertainment. And the reason is, all these politicians, they usually voted into power, they play a game. It's like a movie, like a Hollywood movie. And they are a distraction. So the whole world is talking about what Trump is doing or what he is not doing, what the other party, what the Obamas are doing, or the Bushes are doing. And so we are talking about this movie. In the background, the real things continue. So what is the real agenda behind them? And they are usually not the people with the big power. So the shadow government, or the people who are behind the government, the people with the real money, they are deciding what is happening on our globe. They have a big agenda, and if you see, this agenda is continuing throughout all the presidencies. So if you look at the last four presidents, they all continued the same agenda. So usually they are there. And they are usually allowed to do a little bit different. So like Trump, let's say, he has the right to say a little bit different things, to do a little bit different to distract us. But the important decisions never change. Like in the background, the military industrial complex, they're getting more and more money. The wars, illegal wars around the globe, the human suffering, it continues the same way under all these presidents. They don't make any difference. There's a nice song from Leonard Cohen. It says, I'm neither left nor right. And actually, he was Leonard Cohen. I don't know if you know him. He is interesting because he was a Buddhist monk for a while. He was a Zen monk. And in one of his songs, he also said, I delved very deeply into spirituality, but then cheerfulness came through, and he disrupted. And he started again singing songs after that. And all his songs, they're deep. There are some very deep meaning. I think he had a very deep understanding of what's actually going on around us. And also he's not mainly focusing on that, but you can see it here and there. It is in his songs. So what I mean with the main agenda, if you look at this, every 3.6 seconds a child dies because of hunger or preventable diseases. Now all this is continuing. No, I had never heard any big politician ever talking about it. Nobody's interested, nobody cares. All they care about is this military spending. And interestingly, also that answers also the question we had last time or 2 weeks ago, who is the biggest threat for world peace? You can see US spends a lot more than all the others together. China is number two, that's right. But interestingly, it is estimated that we would need $30 billion a year to overcome world hunger, or to eradicate hunger completely. And that would be the spending of South Korea or Italy, somewhere down there. So it would be a comparable small amount to eradicate all hunger from the world. But that's not what they're interested in. They are interested in military spending, in expanding their powers and doing all the other things. So there is a big lobby for continuing the same agenda. Also the politicians are there to distract us, to play a game so that we don't think about the deep problems around us. Like George Carlin says, never underestimate the power of stupid people in large groups. And if they get together, they can be very dangerous. So meditation is the answer. As we had this in our last discussion, when we talk about these worldly problems all around us, we should know what's going on in our world, But mainly, again, if you want some change, you have to work on your own mind. So if you do your meditation, you develop your mind, you gain more understanding. That's the most important part. But then as a side effect, or automatically also, you see also things which are going on around you. So your eyes are open, you can see on a society level what is going wrong. And then once the eyes are open, it is very difficult to deceive such a person. Or to control a person who is knowing what is going on is a nightmare for anybody who wants to control society. If every 8-year-old in the world is taught meditation, we will eliminate violence from the world within one generation, Dalai Lama. So that would be the most logical thing, to introduce yoga, meditation, basic morality into our school system. But there are only very few schools where they start introducing these things. There is a good development that they use a little bit of mindfulness training now in some schools. Also in some schools they have they introduce real meditation, and in India there are so-called sun schools where they introduce spirituality, and compared with all the other schools, these children are much better. They learn much easier. They are always on top in India. So this would be the future, to introduce it already in the schools and to try to change society. No meditation, no life. No meditation, no life, by Osho. Rumi said this: why do you stay in prison when the door is so wide open? So the solution is here, the practice is here, the meditation is there, and all we have to do to use it and to make some effort and liberate our mind from it. There's a Christian saying, it says, God favors the brave, and I said, liberation favors the diligent. So if you make some effort, you can liberate your mind. As I said, it takes time, it takes energy, and but the technique is there, so let's use it. So free your mind. The Buddha, with his Dharma, strove to bring about an enlightened society found on justice, freedom, community, talent, the universal well-being of the people, and to maximize everyone's potential to lead people towards enlightenment. So that should be our aim, to, for one thing, our own enlightenment, also to liberate society around us, most importantly to have a group of good friends around you, same-minded people with whom you can share all your problems, and then we walk together towards enlightenment. So with that, I come to the end of this Dhamma talk. I hope there were a few points interesting for you. May you all make quick progress in your meditation. May you all find peace and happiness. May you all free your mind and reach higher levels of consciousness. Sadhu, sadhu. At the end, a short chanting to bless you all. Sabitiyo vivacchantu sabbarogo vinasatu mate pavattantarayo sukhiri gayuko bhava pavattu sappamangalam rakkhantu sappadevata sappabhuttanubhavena sada satti bhavantu te sadu sadu. Then at the end a few short announcements. So next Monday, this Monday, Tuesday, I will be at the EWAM Institute. They have the summer school, Buddhist summer school, so I'm invited to do 2 days there, 4 Dhamma talks, Monday and Tuesday. So if you are close there somewhere and you have time, drop in. Not to take away people from BSV, but then the next Dhamma talk here will be on, my next one is on the 20th, it's about reincarnation. Will be about karma, rebirth, reincarnation, also in between states. I got a lot of questions about that one. So it's about analyzing how it works when you are reborn or reincarnation. Then on the in the afternoon, not 100%, is it sure already? Yasmin, is she here? Not here, anyway. We are planning to, on the 20th afternoon, to show a movie. It's the Dhamma Brothers. It's a documentation about a 10-day meditation retreat in an American prison in Alabama. and with amazing results. So they're interviewing the prisoners before, during, and after the retreat. After 10 days, you should see amazing changes in these hardcore criminals. And so we show the movie, and then after that, we have an open discussion starting at 1 p.m. So if you're interested, drop in. I said not 100% because we are still, the movie's on the way. We ordered one, so it's, but we should get it in time. Then my last Dhamma talk for this time will be on the 27th, Awakening Down Under. It's about Buddhism in Australia. Will be also about the bhikkhuni problem, or the sangha problem here in Australia, and also about things which are important to continue your practice towards enlightenment. So I can see in Australia it's really, there is a big awakening, so more and more people get interested in, for one thing, Buddhism, also in meditation, in mindfulness meditation. So it is about Buddhism and positive development in Australia. So with that, everybody is invited to join the lunch on the other side. Before that, if you have any questions, we can do short question and answers. So anything about the Dhamma talk or anything you would like to ask, please do so.
Hi, Martin. I had a question on how the universe was formed. You know, with the Christian tradition, it says there's a God which created the universe,
yeah,
with all the planets, all the stars, all the galaxies. So what is the concept in Buddhism?
The Buddha did not talk much about it, but there are a few suttas which give a hint about it. Now, according to the Buddha, there was like pure consciousness, or we were pure conscious beings. There's one sutta where the Buddha talks, the beings were all floating in space, pure energy, and without any desires, they were happy, they were peaceful, everything was wonderful. And then through grasping, again, it started with attachment, they desired certain things, so they tried some food and things, and so their bodies became more cross and cross. So we basically created our reality, this base reality, out of desire. And that means also because once you get rid of desire, you can go back to pure consciousness. So that's one of the interpretations, that what in other traditions is called God or the creator is pure consciousness, and we are part of it. So we are the creators basically. And there have some people in the West, some people who made some sudden experiences. I remember just one in England. He had some experience in meditation. He started talking, I am God. He said, I am God. And then all England was laughing about him and said, he's crazy, he lost his mind, without really questioning him what he meant with it. So what he meant is we are all pure consciousness. Once you realize that you are kind of God, or you are the creator, you're part of it. So the idea is that it's all on a mental level anyway, so reality is not real, it's mind-made, and we are all together created it. And they say also from moment to moment we create reality. So we perceive it, and also we create it from moment to moment. That's the Buddhist, I think the Buddhist outlook, yeah. But it's a very, very good question, yeah. Deep question. Anything else? Any other questions?
You've talked a lot about desire being the big problem. What about wholesome desires to serve, to help if there's problems going around you?
That's the most difficult part. Now, like you have the hate and desire. Hate is very clear. Now everybody say hate or ill will is obviously bad. We know that. No? It is clear, not a good thing, and it is holding us back. With the desire, let's say with the wholesome desires, even that holds us back. But good desire is leading us even closer to enlightenment. So even some say, let go of your desire to be enlightened even. But you need that desire even to come close to it. So it drives you on. Without, let's say, from this, all the people here would not have no desire anymore, then they wouldn't come here, they wouldn't meditate, they wouldn't do anything. So it is driving you on towards enlightenment, but I say at the last moment, even that you have to let go. In order to become fully enlightened, any kind of desire has to go, but on the way, like compassion, helping others, doing meditation, all these are good things which lead you close to enlightenment. So first of all, you have to try to get rid of the bad desires, keep the good ones or the ones which help you in your meditation to come close to it. But again, in let's say you're sitting in meditation, you should not desire anything. So once you sit in meditation, you should let go of all dualistic thinking, even positive, let's say if it comes in the form of a memory, you remember nice things, or even you desire enlightenment, even these thoughts you should let go. You should not hold on to it. And that's why in meditation, the most, the biggest hindrance are always the thoughts, because they come in different ways. They can come in the form of, it looks like it has to do with my meditation, it has to do with my moving forward, but it is just the thought which holds you back again. So in meditation, we should just note it, move on. In day-to-day life, the positive desires can help you in the beginning, but at the end, you have to let go of it. Okay, thank you. Yeah, anything else? Any other questions?
Well,
oh, there, okay.
I'll project my voice.
Okay, mic is coming.
Do you believe in clairvoyance, in clair audio?
Yes, I think it's possible. Some say there is no magic because it's all natural. So if you're really on a higher level of consciousness, these things happen automatically. That's why many we see this in the there are the stories about the Buddha or many monks who attained enlightenment. In the moment of enlightenment, all these what you call magic powers were also there. They could speak with the spirits, they could see their past lives, they could project themselves into other places. So all these powers are nothing so special once you are on that level. And I think some say this is what you are. And so when you are pure consciousness, there is no limit, you are unlimited consciousness. You could be in two places at the same time, you know everything, you are connected. You feel the connection with all the others around you. So all these things come naturally with spiritual progress. So I believe it's possible, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ajahn, we have one online question from Lee. How do I address intense guilt and regrets?
Guilt and regret. Guilt and regret, yeah. It comes often, and it comes often up in our meditation and really becomes a block or a hindrance. Again, if you see nothing you have done in the past is really wrong. So if you understand everything is part of your growing up or your spiritual progress, even the bad experiences are, we can learn from them. So if you just look back, when the memory comes, say, okay, this I learned from it, I learned my lesson, and it's in the past, it's no longer real. And all I know, it was not a good decision, and I will not repeat it in future. So you make the resolve not to repeat the bad things, but with that, just let it go. So you make this in meditation anyway. When it comes in meditation, it's just a memory, don't even go into it. But outside of meditation, whenever these guilt or memories are coming, you just say, I learned my lesson, it's in the past, and now it's done with it, so I'm not going into it. So the more you think about it, the more it drags you down, and there's no learning from it anymore. So you make your lesson, say, this is what I learned from it, it's in the past, it's no longer real, it's over. In my future, I do better, so I do the right things. And I correct myself. Also, the precepts often are called the Sikkhapada, so these five precepts, they are not meant to like rules written in stone. It is a practice you have to go there. So when it's, let's say a new person starts to keep the five precepts, naturally in the beginning there will be, it will not work always. There will be shortcomings. Sometimes some rules are breaking. Each time you do that, you make the new resolve. You say, okay, this happened, but now I do it better. Now I do it better. So in the process, you are learning, you're purifying your way of life, and one day you will be perfect. So it's a Sikkhapada, a growing up process, and we can learn from our mistakes, but we should not keep it on rolling around in our minds. So we make once the decision, this is the lesson, and in future I won't do it anymore. And then when the memories come, you just block it off. Okay, thank you. I should look in the camera. this one, okay.
How important is the word understanding in practice?
Understanding, what I mean with understanding is wisdom or realization. So if you have some understanding in, you mean theoretical understanding or practical understanding?
Understanding of the things that come up of our defilements.
Okay, the lesson you learn. Yeah, they are very important. So if you look back, you can analyze what happened and why you went into it and what happened after that. So you analyze, you get an understanding of it. It can be a very powerful lesson. That's why I say even bad things we did in the past, if you reflect wisely on it, it can help us immensely. So, but they say even when bad things happen in the moment, there are usually two reactions. One is you just go crazy over it. The other is you say, "Hop, why did this happen? It's not nice, it's not pleasant, but if you overcome it, it can be a big lesson. So you can learn from it, you grow from it if you take it the right way. So in that way, every experience can be very useful, if you have the right outlook. Yeah. Okay, there was one more here.
There is one more online question from Chitra Devi. Just wants you to please explain personality view. Mm.
Sakkaya Ditti is the Bali term for personality view. It is the idea that there is a constant I, me or mine. So the ego idea which drops away with my progressive meditation. So to believe that this is my body and my mind is an entity which is I, me or mine. So this idea drops away. One thing which can help to break this illusion, it usually happens automatically in the meditation, but try to sit down and make the resolve. For 1 minute, I want to sit here and not think anything. And you will very quickly realize it's not possible. So the thoughts are popping up automatically. Or you can try to sit down and say, for 1 minute, I will only think nice thoughts. Again, you will quickly realize it's not possible. So the thoughts are coming out automatically. And also you have no choice. They can be nice thoughts, can be bad thoughts. They come up automatically, so the mind is not you. It is anatta, or not self. The only thing you can, when the thoughts are coming up, after that you have a choice, either to hold on, to push it away, or just to note it. So one way of checking if the mind is you is to sit down and try not to think anything. And also the body we can see is changing. If, I think in one of the suttas the Buddha said, if this body would be you, then you could say, I want to look this way or that way, I want to be duller or bigger, or I want to look differently, it's not possible. So you get the body according to your past karma, so the body mind is not really you. Some say you are, it's like you get it for a dime to make some experiences, but you are not really, it's not really you. So anatta or the Sakkaya Ditti belief would mean this idea there is a I, me or mine which is eternal, which cannot change. And in meditation you realize there is no real ego. In meditation practice it breaks up. That's the, I think, the answer to it. Okay, so I think we stop with that. We are already far gone. Okay, then again, as I said, you're all welcome to join us on the other side for the community lunch. So thanks everybody for coming again and have a very nice Sunday. Thank you.